What are some of the things that it, you discovered and kind of like go, wow, I create my own lane and it's kind of like doing this now? Or let's talk about some of the fun stuff and then let's get into the how-tos of it.
Yeah, you know, just the fun conversations, you know, the ego management conversations. It's getting a little more mainstream, the word ego. But when I started this 8 years ago, talking ego, 10 years ago, I started this, but the term ego really came about 8 years ago. And the first thing out of people, oh, I know someone with an ego. You know, and the funny thing about ego, just to clarify for your audience, is the unconscious brain. We all have one. We're all unconsciously going through the motions 99% of the time. And so when I hear that response, it was always like, oh gosh, here we go. They think the loud, obnoxious guy in the boardroom is the one with the ego. We all have an ego. There's the quiet, passive ego. There's the loud, obnoxious ego. There's the one that just sits back and doesn't say anything, has no emotion. You know, and so being able to really just dig into people's psyche has been the best part. I'm not a therapist, so it really just is that curiosity. Same thing that you do with your, you know, clients that come on here and your visitors, being able to just learn about their life and help them understand why they do what they do.
Right.
Yeah, it's so powerful and it's so rewarding. And I learn more probably than they do every day because I just get to have so many wonderful conversations.
Okay. So, you know, we all, you know, the power of the ego, there's positive vehicles, negative vehicles, there's all kind of dynamics. What were some of the things that you applied to it in the workplace? You found out, you know, this is some of the, let's bullet point some of the work that you do and why and mm-hmm. how it's applicable and how it's helping.
So I, you know, set it up in this Leadership Academy format. And so it's a 20-week course that really just takes people on this journey. And, you know, you start to see people, the most common thing I hear after people start the journey is about 3 weeks in, I'll get calls. It's like, oh my gosh, I had no idea I was so unconscious. I really thought I was aware of my actions. I really thought I was intentional with my conversations. I thought I managed my time well. You know, so all those things that keep us busy, people are realizing those are ego tactics. My ego was controlling my schedule. It was controlling my time. It was telling me I was too busy for the important things. And so that's usually phase one, help people even just own that they have an ego and recognize how it's controlling their days and sabotaging their good intentions. You know, that's the biggest thing, that the unconscious intention is so important to be aware of, especially when you're leading an organization or a team. It's both our strengths and our weaknesses. And so that's the biggest one. The next thing that I hear as people start to go with it is, wow, I am now actually having meaningful conversations instead of typing and talking to my staff or looking at my, you know, messages and my phone as I'm walking down the hallway. I'm making eye contact. I'm having conversations. Obviously, not everybody's in the office right now, but even being able to be intentional enough to pick up the phone instead of just texting or emailing people back right now in that unconscious check the box way, pick up the phone and actually just say, hey, quick 2 minutes, how's everything going? This is the answer to your question. And so again, creating this human interaction because now they're intentionally trying to connect versus just checking the boxes. The personal side, which is absolutely my favorite. So coming from a family that's divorced, being incredibly ambitious myself and not, you know, slowing down enough to build my family's future out, until I was in my 30s, it was like, whoa, this is how the ego does this. You wake up one day and you're either working so hard and you do have the family at home, but the relationships are getting estranged because you work so many hours or you're missing family dinners or you're always justifying a meeting is more important than a sports game. Whatever it is, it happens to all of us. It's not bad, but it's not intentional. And what happens usually is come 50, 60 years old, retirement time, we now have relationships that need repairing because we missed out. And so what my favorite part of this academy is when people start to shift and they start to make more time for their families too. So it becomes balance. When you hear people talk about work-life balance, some people think it's hokey. Like, what does that even mean? This program actually teaches you what that means. You are more intentional at work. You're more balanced there. And then you go home and now you're more intentional and you're balanced there too. And it's just such an awesome thing to hear. Dads are showing up more in their boys' lives or their kids' lives. And moms are able to feel like they can do it all instead of just surviving.
Right. This is fun. And the way you articulated and broke that down with the different types of ego. And I think this will be a fun part to just do this here, you know, from a six human need standpoint of significance, trying to, you know, ego is a byproduct of significance, right? So there's there's all different modalities and ways that you try to achieve your significance to feed the ego. And getting into some of those vehicles, you've broken them down, right? Mm-hmm. So when you have somebody that says, look, I have such a strong need for significance, and this is the vehicle I chose for that, and it's good for me, and it's good for a lot of people, but that's not really good for the greater good. And that's where we run into, you know, people that say, well, but it's gotten, you see great people with great egos and massive, and they're achieving. But then you say, well, how much better could they do if they really became integrated with all the types of ego, all the types of modalities to gain significance? And let's talk about, that'd be fun to talk about the, how you broke it down with the different types of, explain the different types of vehicles for ego. Well, let's go one by one just for fun here. Let's name the
Yeah, I love that. So I refer to three egos. There's the complier, the controller, and the protector. Mm-hmm. And the motivator for each one is the complier wants to be liked and it needs to make sure people are taken care of around them. The protector wants to be right, so very black and white, very factual and tangible. And then you've got the controller, which has to win or be the best. And so when you think about that, we can all identify with one or two of those. So usually we have one to two dominant.
Right. We all have all these, but some are more primary than
others. Absolutely.
Right.